Welcome to Rising Stars, where Miriam Knight, publisher of New Consciousness Review, interviews exciting new voices in the world of progressive and transformational books, films, and ideas, who offer intriguing perspectives on life, the universe, and everything in between. Join us as we celebrate the conscious awakening and explore many expressions of consciousness in action.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Miriam Knight, and I have a co-host with me today, MJ Schwader, who is my business partner in a new venture we're going to tell you about later. My guest today is Fawzia Burke. Fawzia is the founder and president of FSB Associates, an online publicity and marketing firm specializing in creating awareness for books and authors. Fawzia worked for Wiley and Henry Holt before starting FSB, and she's produced and promoted the books of authors such as Alan Alda, Arianna Huffington, and Deepak Chopra. She's a blogger at Huffington Post, Maria Shriver, and Mindbody Green, and she is the author of a new book that we're going to discuss today called Online Marketing for Busy Authors. Welcome, Fawzia.
Thank you so much, Miriam. I appreciate that. That was a lovely introduction. I appreciate it, and I'm so happy to be here with you.
Well, I'm really delighted. I wish that I had spoken with you years ago before I published my book, because your book was a fascinating read. And I know that you've been a publicist for over 20 years. I'm wondering, how have you seen book promotion change over that time?
Oh my gosh, that's such a big question. I'll try to answer that. You know, in some ways, I feel like everything has changed, and in some, you know, in a way, it connects back to the story of why I started my company, which was the first time I saw the potential of the internet allowing people to speak directly to the consumers. You know, before the internet, that was impossible. We sat around in meetings talking about what the readers think and, you know, what the consumers feel. And, you know, it was just sort of just made up stuff. We didn't know. We didn't do market research in publishing. So we really didn't know. And then I, you know, got online in the early days of the internet and through CompuServe and those early networks and started talking to people and realized that I can actually just talk to people. I can ask them what they like, what they don't like. And that sort of really is the change that's been so fundamental in the way that marketing is done from, you know, before the internet to after. And I just felt like, you know, there's no way we can go back to not knowing that. And I think from then on, every tool, every opportunity that we've gotten has just been about connecting readers with their favorite authors, you know, connecting them via Facebook or publicity or, you know, podcasts, you and me talking here. All these opportunities were really not, they've all come in the last 20 years. So I think it's really, fundamentally, it's about the fact that we have so much more access to people that we didn't have before, you know, on both sides, for the authors to have contact with their readers and for the readers to have contact with their authors. It's phenomenal. And I think that's probably mm-hmm. what is the most biggest fundamental change.
Well, your book is called Online Marketing for Busy Authors. And I've been in the business for, pushing 20 years, and so have you. Yeah. And I started as the publisher of a print magazine, and MJ took it over later. And at the beginning, there were actually budgets on the part of publishers to promote the books of their authors. And I have seen this more and more being pushed over into the lap of the authors to deal with as best they can. And I wonder whether book promotion has kind of gone the way of online shopping. I mean, people, you go into a lot of the big box stores and the inventory is down because more and more people are shopping online. So more and more people are definitely looking for information online. So I think your book is very much a valuable, totally valuable contribution to authors at this time. But it kind of leaves, the publishers in an awkward position, which is what we're dealing with. How do you keep your bloggers and your magazine sweet?
Well, I'm going to go back to, you know, something you mentioned, which is so important, which is the responsibility of the authors in today's environment. And what we're seeing more and more, as you said, you know, there's no real tour budget and, you know, a lot of marketing and publicity staff. It's not even that there's cuts in them, which there are, but it's more about how much more is out there now, you know, how much more publicity needs to get done to really break through all of the information that's out there that we're competing with. So, you know, the in-house people in publishing houses, all many of them my friends, and I think they do an extraordinary job and they work very, very hard. It's just not enough time to do everything that they need to do. And so the ownership of the author taking control of their own brand is not only kind of response, you know, it's not only just that it's the author's responsibility, but in my opinion, I think it's the privilege of the authors to really have this opportunity to connect directly with their readers, build that platform, come to the publisher with you know, resources, digital assets that they can tap into. And when I see when authors have that, you know, they're definitely opened up to more opportunities. So they can get a book deal and get a speaking engagement and get a podcast and things like that, because you're able to bring an audience to whatever opportunity you see. So I think most publishers are delighted when the authors have sort of a platform of their own, and it does make it, you know, easier for them to promote them. It's certainly easier to book them because they have this platform. And then the second, of course, part of that question is that, you know, really the reason I wrote this book is because most of my authors are just so busy. You know, they have a full-time mm-hmm. job, they mm-hmm. have a family, they've written a book, and they don't really like marketing. You know, I'm a nerd. I like marketing. I like data, and I like, you know, I look at trends and all that kind of stuff. But most of my authors don't want to be marketers. That's not their sweet spot. That's not their favorite part. So, but that ship has sailed. You know, that part that, you know, if you don't like it, you don't have to do it, is just not an option. So I tried to mm-hmm. make the book really accessible for people with the understanding that majority of the people who are reading the book are not interested in doing the marketing. They know it's necessary. They know they have to do it, but it's not their first choice. You know, it's not something that they really have time for. So I tried to make it so people could understand the priorities that are worth doing. You know, there's a lot to do, and everybody has an opinion about what authors should be doing. So I really try to tell them what's worth it, what's not worth it, you know, what's worth driving yourself crazy for and what's not. So that was sort of the genesis of the book, is really understanding that there's a lot of authors out there who really don't want to be marketers but have to be at this point.
Absolutely. You start with talking about your personal brand. Why is personal branding so important, and what are the key elements that an author needs to focus on?
Well, personal brand, in all honesty, I think, you know, if we get away from the marketing lingo, it really is your story. It's the story of your career, and sometimes it's the story of your, you know, your life even. But it's really about how do we tell people what we're about? How do we communicate with people about where we're going, what our vision is, where we've come from? It's that sort of storytelling. And if you do it well, then it doesn't sound like a promotional, you know, all me, all the time radio station. It can really be interesting because people are interested in other people, and we want to know who we're communicating with. So in the basic sense, it's really about telling a story. That's really building a brand. And then from there, we talk about what are the tools that you need for that storytelling. And, you know, obviously you need a website. For so many authors, they think, oh, do I really need a website? And I have to tell them, yes, absolutely. You need one place. That's your home base, That's the seat of your brand, that whether you control all the content, you control all the information. And then you can build on that with engagement through certain social media, newsletters, and then on top of that, you create visibility through online publicity or offline publicity. So it really is sort of a staged approach, in my opinion. You know, you have to make sure that your brand is in the design sense, in how you represent yourself in design, whether it's a website or your photo or your graphics, that they all look professional and they represent your work. And then on top of that, you build engagement through social media, newsletters, that, those sort of things. And then on top of that, you build visibility, which is creating exposure outside of your network, you know, on different websites or radio show or TV show or things like that. So that's sort of the, that's what I believe personal branding is really all about.
I was really impressed as I was reading the book at how applicable the advice you give is to any business owner, any coach, you know, whether or not they have a book. Of course, a book is really, really important to their platform, wouldn't you say?
Yes, absolutely. And I'm so glad you said that because I did have that in mind. My publisher even thought that, you know, maybe we shouldn't narrow the book title so much and try to be a little bit broader. But, you know, what I came back to is sort of my experience online, which is in some ways the more specific you are, the more targeted you are, I think the better off you are. You know, if I tried to aim for everybody, I don't think I would have been able to do it. So what we try to do is try to be more specific, and since I've worked with authors, that's what I focus on.
Right. Well, we'll pick that up when we come back from our break. We're speaking with Fawzia Burke about her book, Online Marketing for Busy Authors. I'll be right back.
Your conscious lifestyle on steroids. OM Times Radio, IOM FM. As difficult as it is to believe, there are places in Africa where human traffickers sell albino children and their body parts for use in magic rituals. Humanity Healing International is actively working in Uganda to change this paradigm. The Albino Rescue Project finds albino children who are at risk and places them in safe schools and environments where they can learn and grow free from fear. To learn more or to sponsor a child, visit humanityhealing.org. Humanity Healing is where your heart is.
Hi, everyone. This is Shea Parker, the host of Best of the Best, which airs live right here on IOM Radio every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern and 5 p.m. Pacific. I'm super excited to bring you expert guest hosts, spiritual discussions, free psychic readings, and so much more. I can promise that you will not want to miss this one-of-a-kind, fun, yet touching, down-to-earth show. Join us every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Pacific on OTRFM. This is Shea Parker, and I can't wait to see you there.
I am Fidel Nshombo. I was born in a city called Bukavu in the Congo.
We were a loving family, and then, boom, everything that I had disappeared in a single day.
People think that when you are a refugee and they resettle you to America, and all your problems are done. They don't understand that that's the beginning of everything.
I was not born a refugee. I was made one.
It's time we welcome refugee families with open arms. Learn more at embracerefugees.org, brought to you by the Ad Council.
Welcome back. I'm Miriam Knight speaking with Fawzia Burke about her book, Online Marketing for Busy Authors. Fawzia, I've known your company for many, many years, and it's funny only now getting to speak with you, but it's been a pleasure working with your team.
Thank you so
much. And, of course, with your authors.
Yes, yes, exactly. I'm so grateful for your support, and they've always really enjoyed their conversations with you. So when I had the opportunity, I jumped. I thought, this is great. Thank you.
Well, you say that the age of the generalist is over. So how does a person go about finding their niche?
Well, I think that's a tough question because, you know, in my opinion, I think the niche sort of finds you. You know, I think we're all good at certain things. We sort of have passion for certain things. And those, when you start working in that area, I feel like you're more in the flow of that work, and it sort of connects you. So I don't know if I have a formula on how to do it, but I do feel that, you know, if you follow your passion and you follow the work that really makes you happy, then that work becomes your niche. You know, that's where you end up getting sort of known for your work. And, you know, in my company, we've always been very focused on online publicity for authors. You know, it's a very narrow niche, but we have deep roots in it, and it fuels us because we love the work, and I feel like, you know, we can stay on top of it, we can sort of stay ahead of it, and it doesn't one day bore me, or I think, oh, I wish I could do something else. You know, it's something that really fuels me every day, and I feel like having that niche really keeps me focused. And there have been times, obviously, in ups and downs in businesses where you think, oh, I should have expanded, or, you know, maybe we should have a more diversified portfolio or something like that. But I keep coming back to what I feel like I do best and what my team does best. And, you know, we ride out the rough patches and come back to this idea that the things that we really feel passionate about and the things that we feel we do well, I'd rather do one thing to the best of our abilities than try to do a lot of different things not as well. You know, there's a lot to learn these days, especially in the area that I'm in. Things change so much, and, you know, opportunities keep growing, and there's, you know, new tools out all the time. And it would be impossible to just sort of do that half-heartedly. You have to sort of be all in. And I think when you're all in, you're more successful. So that's just sort of my philosophy. And I just feel like, you know, trying to be everything to everyone is just too difficult.
I think that's very wise advice. And I noticed that in your book, you had sort of checklists that people could go through and maybe write out their own preferences to narrow down the potential niche that they could address. You also talk about figuring out who your main audience. That's another tricky question.
Yes, totally important.
You correlate the audience with the kind of marketing approach that you will take. Can you give us some kind of highlights on that?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, there are times when authors will call me and say something like, you know, whatever the book is, it will appeal to everyone. And I always have to tell them there is no everyone. You know, there we have to come up with communities. Actually, I have this line that I tell people, there's no everyone.com. But maybe there is, who knows.
Yeah.
But there isn't a way to just talk to everybody. You have to, especially online, you know, we're all segmented. Everybody has particular interests that they're looking for. And, you know, you, for example, your own radio show, you know, you do these amazing shows on health and wellness and all that kind of stuff. And so people know what to look for when they come to your show. And you build a brand around that. You know, even if people haven't heard this morning, I heard a interview with one of the authors on your show. And, you know, I bought their book right from that radio station, the radio show, your interview with them. And I knew that that's the kind of information that I would get from your shows. And I think that when you build that kind of brand where people have faith and trust in what you're going to give them and what you're going to deliver to them, it works much better. So for audiences, what happens is authors will think, you know, I've had these authors who said, I think what I should do is go climb on top of the Apple store in New York and with a bullhorn announce my book, because that'll get me a lot of publicity. People will look around. People will search for me. They'll want to figure out what the hell I'm talking about. And, you know, sure, sounds like a good idea, but the chances – it doesn't sound like a good idea. I was being sarcastic. But, but you know, the chances that your exact audience is going to be part of that group of people walking around Manhattan – at that particular moment and will be curious and not put off by your approach is just small. So if you were saying to me, there was another author of mine who thought he should have flyers handed out to everyone who walks down Park Avenue by hot girls. That was his exact line. You know, if hot girls were handing out flyers about my book, people would be interested. And again, it's one of those things that, you know, the idea that someone walking by is going to be your exact reader is just not possible. And people do that online, too. I'm giving you two examples of offline ideas that I've heard from authors. But online, too, I had one author who asked me if I could get his book on Gap.com. And I said, the jeans company, like Gap.com? And he said, yes. And I said, why? And he said, well, because their demographic is perfect for my book. And I just had to tell him, I said, have you ever seen a book on that website? You know, if they have never done that before, the chances that they're going to do that for your book are just slim. So it's important that once you figure out your audience, then you can really decide on what kind of marketing efforts would work. So, for example, if you were writing a graphic novel and you went to Comic-Con and you had hot girls or not, hot girls or hot boys, or no one handing out flyers about your book at Comic-Con, that makes a lot of sense, right? Because every single person who's going to Comic-Con is probably more inclined to reading a comic novel than anyone else, graphic novel than anyone else. So it's just trying to be more selective in your approach. So when you do have those ideas, instead of thinking, you know, general audience, Park Avenue, anyone who walks by, to Comic-Con, you know, people who are interested in graphic novels and giving the flyers at the show, you can see why one would be so much more effective than the other. And this, we have the same approach online. You know, I've worked on books that are, let's say, for health disease, you know, heart disease. And people will say to me, well, everyone has a heart. And that is so true. Everyone does have a heart, but you can't really promote to everyone in, you know, in every capacity. You really have to go promote it to people who are discussing health and, you know, cardiac health, and really try to focus on the people who are actually involved in that topic. And then it can grow from there. But if you try to see, if you try to go for everyone, you actually end up missing, you know, your most crucial audience. So that's why, mm-hmm. you know, really narrowing down your audience makes such a big impact, because then you can say, okay, if this is my audience, you know, what kind of TV shows do they watch? What kind of conferences do they attend? What kind of websites do they go to? Do they, and even in the demographic of your age group, you can decide whether this group is on LinkedIn or on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram. So you can actually focus your attention on the networks that will lead you directly to your audience rather than trying to do everything for everyone.
And that leads us to the whole question of social media, which for people of my generation, it's the kind of thing that you know you have to do, but you do it through gritted teeth. And I have been to so many websites where you see a blog and they start off with three blog postings, one right after the other in 2015, and then there's maybe one in 2016 and so on. So, what is the best advice you can give about social media?
Well, I think your point is really well taken. Most of us get really busy. This is extra work for all of us, right? I mean, I do this for a living, and even for me to keep up with my own branding is extra work because my clients come first. And when I have time, I can focus on myself, but that's, you know, and I know what to do. And for everyone else, that's exactly the point. So what happens is that, you know, when you have a new product coming out or you're launching something, a book or a podcast or a, you know, new service, then everybody's very gung-ho, very excited, and they will post, you know, blogs and are active on social media on a regular basis. And then sort of, you know, there's an arc to that launch, and when it starts to sort of taper off, then people start to lose interest and they go back to doing other things. And that happens over and over again. And my biggest advice to everyone I talk to is consistency. You know, it is so important mm-hmm. that you stay consistent, because the idea that you can show up and ask people to commit to your new program, your new book, your new whatever it is, and get excited about it, and then you completely disappear, it just doesn't work that way. You know, if you think about social media like normal life, if you were treating your friends that way, you know, where you were communicating with them when you needed their help and when you needed their attention, and then totally disappeared when you didn't, you wouldn't have many friends either. So mm-hmm. it's so important that, you know, it doesn't have to be a very aggressive schedule. You can take your, you know, you can decide what, how often you can blog or how often you can send your newsletter. Do the best you can. There's no, you know, nobody sitting around waiting for your blog or your newsletter. So it's okay if you miss a deadline or something like that. But just don't disappear. Don't completely disappear. Just stay as active as you can be. Maybe write in and say, I've been swamped writing, you know, doing all sorts of research for my book. And even share that research. Say where you've been. Maybe you've been traveling. Maybe you've been in the library for 4 days. Something like that. So people understand what's going on. They feel part of the process. Not feel like you're only taking advantage of their attention when you need something. And then as far as social media is concerned, you know, the Facebook and Twitter, LinkedIn, those kinds of things, what I tell people is just focus on two. Because if you try to do too many of these things, you just won't be able to keep up with it. Pick mm-hmm. two that your audience shares, you know, you have an audience there, but also that you enjoy. You know, some people love taking photos on their phone, and so for them, Instagram is perfect. I'm particularly not really that good about that. You know, I completely forget to take photos. I'm one of those people who I feel like, you know, when I'm in an experience, I really want to experience that experience and not see it from behind my camera. So I'm not really very good about taking a lot of photos or constantly taking pictures or things like that. So for me, Facebook and Twitter is really a wonderful way for me to connect with people, learn from other people, communicate. And I've focused more on that. Not that I don't learn those other tools. I do, just to make sure that I know what they are. And, you know, I try to have a presence somewhere. On whether it's Pinterest or Instagram or LinkedIn or something. But you do have to see what works best for you and what you enjoy doing. And if you enjoy doing it, some of my clients enjoy Pinterest, so I tell them to spend time on that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, there's another break. My goodness, yes. The time is going quickly. Stay with us and we'll be right back with Fawzia Burke talking about online marketing for busy authors.
Free your mind with Om Times Radio, IOM FM.
Ascending Hearts is no ordinary dating site, but a spiritual dating site with a purpose, to link you with your soulmate. We engineer the serendipity so you can trust that you will attune with someone that has the same matching vibration as you. Ascending Hearts, the conscious dating site for the spiritually aware. Try Ascending Hearts for free, ascendinghearts.com.
Grab a cup of tea or a glass of wine and tune in for Inspired Conversations with publisher Linda Joy on Tuesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern. Linda creates sacred space for leading female luminaries, empowering authors, heart-centered female entrepreneurs, coaches, and healers. A soulful venue where guests openly share the fears and obstacles they've overcome, wisdom and lessons learned, and the personal journey that led them to the transformational work they do in the world. Inspired Conversations, to empower you on your path to authentic, soulful living.
Sparky the Fire Dog here. Make sure your family has a fire escape plan, and they practice it twice a year. One important thing to practice is get low and go. If you see or smell smoke, it's important to get low and go. Protect your family from fire. For more information, visit sparky.org.
We want to keep you, your family, and your community safer from fire. This message brought to you by the National Fire Protection Association and your local fire department. Visit sparky.org.
And we're back with Fawzia Burke and MJ Schwader. MJ, we haven't heard from you yet. I wanted to perhaps introduce the subject of our new project because, Fawzia, you're dealing with people who already have a book that they want to promote, even though you said that they should create their platform before they even publish the book. And MJ and I are just coming out with a new website that we hope to launch this week. MJ, do you want to tell the world about it?
Sure. Just a little bit of background. I've been a writing coach. I've been on the other side of the book industry for the last 20 years. I'm one of the first writing coaches after the coaching wave came out. And so I've been helping publishers, helping authors become published. And in that coaching, I've also, in the last 20 years, studied a lot of online marketing, and I coached them on creating their platform. So when Miriam and I started collaborating last year, I was looking at that and invited Miriam to join me. So we're launching a new website called Platform Crafters. So we take people from inspiration through the writing coaching, through the building of their platforms. So Miriam, take it away.
Yes. So Platform Crafters is what we're trying to do as our day job, because one of the sad, bittersweet aspects of this show today, Fawzia, is that it's going to be my last show on Om Times. And I love everybody to bits associated with Om Times, but I've been working for free for too long. What we find, both in the magazine publishing and in the podcasting world, is that the publicists come to us with wonderful authors, and most of us in this business are really in it because of deep conviction and wanting to contribute to the world. And we find it very difficult to say no, but we really would love to get paid for our work. And that hope happens really so infrequently that, as I said, MJ and I are doing this as a day job. So it's platformcrafters.com. Yeah.
That's wonderful. I will definitely check it out. Congratulations to both of you for launching something new. If there's anything we can do at FSB to help promote it, please let us know. We would be more than happy to help you in any way possible. You've always been very kind to us and our authors. And I'm sorry that you're not going to be doing, you're so good at it, but I understand. I think that the sort of who pays for what has shifted so much in the last few years that it's become really challenging to figure this out. And my authors are asked and expected to do a lot of blogging and op-ed writing and, doing a lot of the work that journalists used to do that they have to do now, mm-hmm. and they have to do it for free. Mm-hmm. So they're not particularly happy about that either. Promotional opportunities that publishers used to pay for, they don't have the budget to pay for. So it's just become a sort of challenging environment to try to figure out who actually pays for the work. We've all been doing a lot of free work, and I think it's coming to a head for everybody.
Well, you mentioned blogging, and you have a chapter called To Blog or Not to Blog. So what is the answer?
Well, I think, there's definitely benefits to blogging. If you blog on your own website, it helps you bring traffic. People can do keyword searches and find you and come back to your website. And, that helps your SEO ranks in a much better way than trying to just trick Google into coming to your website, which is SEO, which doesn't really work long term. So blogging really does help in bringing traffic to your website. It also gives people an opportunity to see what you do. So instead of just telling people what you do, you actually show them what you do. You share your expertise, you're sharing your resources in that way. And then, if you blog for other sites for free, you do it because it brings exposure to you and it builds credibility. It brings traffic back to your website. So in some ways, you're saving money on advertising, but you're spending it on, human capital work.
Yeah.
And so for all those reasons, I think blogging is still really important. Where we go from here, I don't know. But I think video is becoming a really important way for people to connect with other people and certainly their audience. So maybe we'll see more of video. Obviously, as podcast is still very big and getting bigger. So there may be other ways that we can communicate this information, but for the time being, because we're so dependent on search engines for finding us and finding our websites, that we do need that text blogs still. So I think it's really important for authors to blog, yes.
So they put in so much effort, we put in so much effort to raise their profile and their discoverability on the web.
Yes.
What would you say is the business model? Because very, very few, vanishingly few authors make any money off their books. How do they make their money?
Well, I think fiction is a little bit more challenging just because, you know, people are sometimes they'll write a novel, but then they'll also teach a class or they'll do other sort of opportunities, you know, other ways to share their resources. I was at a conference recently called the Business Writers Conference, and they were specific about, you know, who they're targeting. It was business authors. And a lot of the discussion was about not just book sales, because, you know, we all know we're not making money on book sales. It was all of the other opportunities you can have, whether it's speaking engagements or consulting or workshops or online courses or podcasts or something like that. So there was all these other avenues that the book opens doors for. I think it's a little bit less for fiction, but even for fiction, I think I've seen authors who are, you know, they're teaching at local libraries or junior schools or senior schools, and they are doing online courses, and they're doing consulting work, or they're doing what MJ is doing, which is editing and helping people get published. So I think there are, because there's this whole explosion of self-published authors, the services that publishers provide now have to be outsourced, right? So these people are really building almost an entire team of people and trying to get them to do the same services that a publishing house does for authors. And I think that I've seen authors do that. You know, they've published their own books successfully, so they help other people successfully publish. And I think we're all sort of trying to find our own way in terms of how do we actually make money on all of this? And for my own business, you know, the book sales have been, I certainly haven't become a New York Times bestseller or anything like that. So they've been modest, I would say, even for me. But then it's really helped my business, because people who read my book and read my approach, you know, they either resonate with it and like how I work or they don't. But at least if they do, then they know how to hire us for our services. So it's increased my business that way. I'm speaking at a lot of conferences where they actually pay me, when before the book, I used to have to pay for myself, right? I had to pay for my expenses, and they didn't pay me to speak. But somehow, once you become an author, you have a different level of expertise. So that has helped that. I'm also doing consulting work. So I think in a lot of different ways, I just did a workshop, a full-day workshop in person, and I plan to do an online course as well. So I think that, you know, it's just finding different ways to really share that expertise and share that information with people, and I think we're going to see more and more of that.
And that's exactly why we moved into the platform. That was exactly why we're doing the platform Crafters, because that's what we're doing, is helping people not only write the book, but then repurpose that message into a number of different ways, strategies for both marketing-wise and revenue generation. So that's exactly
awesome.
What we're doing is
exactly like online courses and apps, web apps, and so on. So.
And I want to add one of media training.
Right.
Miriam will be helping people with podcasts, et cetera, too, as well.
Oh, great. Yes. Well, you certainly have that experience, and I know more and more people are trying to do that. So it seems like you both have very specific skills that you can bring to this enterprise, and I know that authors are looking for that. So I'm excited. I can't wait to check out the website.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Now, if you have limited time and you're investing in your book, you're investing in a certain amount of social media. I like the distinction you made between social media and social networking. So media is the posts and networking is the activity. It's all built on relating with your audience. I thought that was such an important message because so many of us, you know, are able to automate. For example, every time I post a new show, it automatically gets tweeted and Facebooked and so on.
Right.
And
right.
I realized in reflecting on this that I'm missing out on the opportunity of deepening the relationship with my audience.
Right. And I think we need a hybrid approach. You know, there's no way we can all be living on social media. You know, we have lives, we have businesses, we have to make money. And so it's not something where we can stay online all the time. So we do need some things that are scheduled, for sure. You know, if we can come up with ways that we can schedule certain things. When you have a new show, that can be scheduled, that's fine. But then you do, you know, some people just schedule things and then never check in, you know, never respond, never mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. anything, never retweet anybody else. And that's not going to be feasible because it's not about the numbers. It's really about the engagement. I've worked with authors who have, you know, a huge number of followers, but really hardly any engagement because they have this automated, sometimes paid by, you know, a PR firm or someone else mm-hmm, who's mm-hmm. doing their scheduling for them, so they're not even involved in it. And so there's no engagement. Nobody responds. Nobody, you know, they're not responding. It feels very one way. And I think that idea of understanding the distinction between social media and social networking was really a aha moment for me as well, Miriam, because I just thought, oh, that's how it, you know, this is how we can distinguish it. This is how we can plan things and say, you know, what are we doing in social networking and what are we doing in social media to really give us a good, well-rounded approach to online publicity and marketing for ourselves. And networking is really a one-to-one method, you know, it's you talking to one person and that person talking back to you and responding and engaging with each other. And if our attitude is that I'm talking to one person, even though other people are listening, it becomes a little bit more intimate. It becomes a little bit more useful. And then we still need a social networking strategy, which is what I say is a one-to-many distribution channel. So whether it's your blog or a podcast or something like that, where you're creating content and sharing it with a lot of people, I think you have to do both. You have to be engaged on a one-to-one level, but then you also have to do sharing your expertise and sharing your work with many people at the same time.
It's such a new and rapidly changing world. It's fascinating to keep up with. Do you have a favorite social media platform that you use? I mean, just one, if you would recommend.
Yeah, I would say authors should really look at the demographic and match that. So, you know, that's
right.
What's most important.
And you do have, yes, and you have hints in your book as to which demographic goes with which platform.
I do.
So we'll be right back with our final segment with Fawzia Burke, talking about online marketing for busy authors.
Bringing you the best of the conscious minds in the world. Om Times Radio, your conscious lifestyle on steroids. Being a radio host on IOM FM allows you to build your show on a rich platform with the power of the internet to fulfill your outreach goals and connect with a very specialized and global online audience, unlimited by time and distance. Om Times Radio will provide you with web relevance, a recognizable conscious brand, and with the standard of excellence that has accompanied every single Om Times endeavor. Host your show with Om Times Radio Network.
Hello, I'm Lisa Barry. Join me every Monday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time for Light on Living, a chance to see new, hear different, and feel more as I shine the spotlight on all the ways to lighten the load of life's challenges. Light on Living is your link to that new way you're looking for, that new understanding that will enhance your life, and that positive connection that will support your growth. So join me, and you'll gain insight and start to see things in a new way that motivates you.
Today, my new dad threw a barbecue.
I burnt everything.
and then we played catch.
I broke Mr. Lewis's window, and then somehow my hand!
And then my dad even let me drive his car.
The hospital's on the right!
It was a rough day.
It was a great day.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of kids in foster care will take you just as you are. For more information on how you can adopt, visit AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt U.S. Kids, and the Ad Council.
And we're back. Fawzia, what website can people find you at?
My name is kind of unusual, so if they find my name, they should be able to find my website. It's fawziaburke.com, so that's FAUZIABURKE.com. My company website is fsbassociates.com, so that's fsbassociates.com, and either one of them would bring you to the other one.
And, of course, she has an account at every possible social media site.
Yes, if you can't find me, I've not done my job, for sure.
Right. So tell me about podcasting. Where does that rank in terms of your recommendations to authors?
Well, there are two different things. One is doing podcasting yourself, so something like being in your position, which is that you get a chance to interview authors. And in some ways, you know, all of the interviews that you've done, you have contacts with all of these authors, and now that your new enterprise is really more for author-centric, you have people who know you, you know, who spend an hour with you in being interviewed by you. So you have a little bit of a built-in audience and connection with your potential, you know, customers, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So in some ways, even if it is free for some authors, there are other benefits to it. You know, there are other opportunities, that networking opportunities that come from it. And, you know, if you get the podcast big enough, then you get bigger authors, and maybe the next time you write a book, they're willing to write an endorsement for you and things like that. So, you know, although it's not a money-making enterprise for authors doing it, you know, doing the podcast themselves, it's a way to share information, it's a way to network, it's a way to connect with people. The other benefit of it is that for some people, doing a podcast, whether it's 15 minutes, 10 minutes, not interviewing people, just sort of talking about something that's important to them, is easier than writing. So they feel like they can just do that, and then they have content, and that gives them another way to share their expertise. And then on the other hand, you know, for authors to be on shows, so being on the other side of the channel, that's really important because, you know, people are pulling information to them and subscribing to podcasts that work for them. So, you know, you have many, many more opportunities to target an audience on podcasts versus, like, regular radio. Podcasts, you know, there are podcasts that are just for small businesses. There are podcasts just for startups. There are podcasts for people like, you know, that you do, which is spirituality and health and well-being. And so you can find a podcast or many podcasts for each audience. And if you know your audience and you can tap into that, then you're really connecting with 100% of that audience is your potential book buyer. So it's better to do that than trying to be on, in my opinion, you know, some generic radio station where maybe two people, maybe four people are your audience, but everybody else is, you know, interested in something else. So I think on both fronts, podcasts have benefits for authors.
And I would like to put a plug in here for the Om Times Network, because they are wonderful people to work with. They have a wonderful exposure. So if you're looking, if you're an author and looking to start a podcast, speak to Chris and Liani Buck at ohmtimes.com. So, I'm going to miss them. Yeah. I was looking at some of the people that you have promoted books for, and I noticed Alan Alda. I was such a fan of his in the old days. Was he great fun to work with?
Oh, my God. Over 20 years of having my own company, he's absolutely hands down my favorite client. He's just been a complete gem to work with. His third book is coming out this year. We're working on that one as well. We've worked on the last two, which also became New York Times bestsellers. But he's just been a wonderful, wonderful collaborator to work with. He's just an excellent human being. And I have the story of the first time he called my office. You know, usually if I'm working with celebrities, their people call their office, you know, their publicist or their managers or their agents or something like that. So my assistant came into my office and said, Alan Alda's on the phone. And I started laughing, thinking somebody's pulling a, you know, basically joking with me. So I picked up the phone and said, hello, Alan, thinking it's some friend of mine. And he said, hello. And it was his, you know, he has such a distinctive voice. I said, oh, my God, you're Alan Alda. And he said, I said that. No, I just didn't believe it. So that's kind of how our conversation started. And we met him and, you know, have had meals with him. I've been to his home. And him and his wife, Arlene, are absolutely two of the most wonderful people on the planet. And it's really quite an honor and privilege to be able to promote their books. And the first book we got, you know, we met as complete strangers. And when I finally met him for the first time, I was so nervous. I shook his hand and I said, I'm sorry, I'm so nervous. And he said, oh, don't be nervous. You're an expert at what you do. I'm an expert at what I do. We're equals. And I thought, kind of not equals, but okay.
Wow,
so it was just wonderful. He put me at ease and we had a wonderful time working together on his first book, and it became a New York Times bestseller. And then when his second book came out, he called me and he said, would you mind working with me again? And I thought, no, I would not mind at all. So it's just been a wonderful relationship with him. And, you know, he's been very generous and kind and just fun to work with. He's a wonderful collaborator, wonderful collaborator.
What's his new book about?
It's called If I Understood You, I Wouldn't Have This Expression on My Face. So it's a long title, and it's a beautiful cover. The cartoonist from The New Yorker actually drew him on the cover, so it's a little bit of a cartoon on the cover. And it's actually a really wonderful book about communication and how we learn things and how we, you know, communicate with each other. He has the sort of these tricks of improv, not comedy, improv, that he uses in ways to communicate with people, learn more about, how do we find out more information from each other. It's a really wonderful, wonderful book, and he's a little bit of a science nerd. I'm sure he wouldn't mind me saying that. He loves science, and so there's information in there on science and communications and, you know, just ways to improve communication in all capacity, whether it's business or personal. So it's a really wonderful book and comes out on June 6th.
Oh, I look forward to it.
Yes.
I heard John Cleese, he was in Portland last month, and he also consults to companies on communication. So I think that's just perhaps an indication that a bit of humor goes a long way in bridging the gaps between me and thee.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. I think so, for sure. It's wonderful.
So we've got just a few minutes before the end of the show. I've been chatting away. MJ, do you have any final questions?
No, you've been covering it great, and I've been learning a lot. I'm looking forward to learning more from you, Katya.
Well,
okay.
Thank you, MJ.
Oh, I know. There was one more point.
Sure.
There was one more point I wanted to make.
Of course.
Sorry. I just wanted to make one more point that I got from your book, and I think it's a very important one, which is that in this age of instant everything, consistency and long-term is the name of the game here. You can't expect instant results. And my question to you, Fawzia, is how long should it take to see results, and what results should you be looking for?
Right.
Good question.
And, you know, yeah, it is a really good question. And what I've seen authors really almost – not everyone, because sometimes we get lucky. And, you know, one of my blogs, for example, on a site called Mind Body Green, has been shared over 47,000 times. I can't imagine anything I would write would just be shared as much as that has. But, you know, I've also written a ton of other things that have not connected with people quite as well. So, you know, sometimes it happens very quickly, and you see that result, and you see people responding and tweeting and all that kind of stuff. And then other times, I would say that it's better to think about looking for a change in your sort of branding status about 18 months to 2 years. That's probably more realistic and probably more where you can really start to see, oh, look at this. Now, because of this level of branding, because I've been consistently building it, you know, I have an opportunity to do more consulting or charge more for consulting, or I can expand my business, or, you know, I'm seeing more book sales, or I'm seeing more people engage with me on social media. And all of that is good, but, you know, at the end of the day, we do have to make money. So what I've seen, that the 18 months to 2 years is really about when people start to see more tangible results for their effort.
Right. Well, here we are at the end of the show. We've been speaking with Fawzia Burke about online marketing for busy authors. Miriam Knight and MJ Schwader, soon from platformcrafters.com. So if you want to write your book and need some help, we're here for you.
Thank you very much, and I wish you all the best in your endeavor.
Thank you. And Chris and Liani, thank you for everything.
Take care, Miriam.
Goodbye.